Okay, hi everyone. My name is Benny Pinkas from Bar-Ilan University in Israel, and I'm going to talk about implementations of pseudo-random number generators. Before I do that, I do some advertisement for another winter, another school. We're going to have a winter school at Bar-Ilan. It's the seventh winter school we're having, seventh annual winter school. It's going to be in mid-February. The weather is going to be about what you experience here today, unless it's going to rain. So it's going to be very nice. This year, the school is going to be on differential privacy from theory to practice. We have a very nice set of speakers. And if you want to learn about differential privacy, you're very invited to register. You have the URL there, or you can search for the, for the winter school. Okay. You can ask, I mean, some people here have been in past events at Bar-Ilan at these winter schools, and they're usually, very nice, educating and fun events. So in this talk, I'm going to talk about pseudo-random number generation, as is done by common operating systems, and all kinds of implications of that. So part of this talk is going to be about research I've done about 10 years ago on the actual implementations of pseudo-random number generators in Windows and Linux. Then I talk about some implications of the findings we had in Linux. And then at the end, I must save some time to talk about the recent backdoor in the random number generator used in Juniper products. Juniper products, they have they control a lot of the firewall and router market, and backdoor there in the random number generator is it's a very serious issue. Okay, so first I'll talk about the insecurity of the pseudo-random number generators of Linux and Windows. This was done with some very good students, Zvika Gutermann, Leo Dorendorf, and Tzachi Reinmann, who did a lot of systems work. So this is this work is a lot about systems. I won't have any theorem in this work, in this presentation, okay? No theorem, probably almost no math, okay? Talk about systems. Okay, so I'll talk, can you see that? Yeah. How pseudo-random number generators are implemented, why is it important to check how they're implemented, specifically on the generators used by Windows and by Linux, the algorithm and the weaknesses, and security issues when you're using a generator in systems without a hard disk. Okay, so what are random number generators? Usually I have this slide, what are random number generators? You know about that. Why are they important? So in cryptography, like every cryptographic construction usually says something like we have in the bottom, pick a key at random, something like this. So security depends on using random numbers. And the question is how we pick them. So a computer, of course, cannot flip coins. So we need to somehow pick a random number generator. And for instance, in Windows, they call this function cryptgenRandom, which provides, in this case, 16 bytes of random bits and inputs it to this variable, the key. And this is relevant for any cryptographic construction that we might use. So when we design cryptographic construction, we just say, OK, let's use random number generators. But people who implement them actually use whatever the operating system usually provides them. And if someone can, if the operating system that doesn't provide secure, truly random numbers, then all the constructions based on random numbers are insecure. If someone can tamper with the generation of random numbers, then also the same happens. So this is a major thing. If the source of random numbers used by ordinary computers is insecure, then all the cryptographic constructions we build on top of it are insecure. Here's another example. It's not necessarily it's not a cryptographic construction, but here is you're doing HTTP with the server, so HTTP is stateless. So how, when I go to a site over and over again, how does the server know that I'm the same person? So usually the first time I connect to the site, I get this random session ID. And in each future connection I make to the site, I have to send this session ID, okay? And then it knows that it's actually me, okay? And this next session could be, you know, where I'm getting, you know, my bank account information or my email or whatever. So everything here depends on this session ID. I mean, everything is encrypted. But if the session ID is not properly, it's not random, then someone else can guess it, and then it can try to impersonate me using this session ID. And this is, okay, work for, so for instance, Zvika Gutemann and Daria Malchi showed in 2005, specifically on an Apache Java implementation, that these session IDs were not random. And, you know, the guys who implemented the server, I mean, they had a lot of things to do on their mind, right? So it's not realistic to expect them to generate random numbers properly. So someone, probably the operating system, has to provide good random numbers for them. Because, you know, they haven't been in this course this week. They have a lot of other things to do. They need to ship something very, you know, quickly. We need to provide them with random numbers. So applications are designed to be secure if they're using truly random bits, but it's hard to get truly random bits. Therefore, we are using pseudo-random number generators, and applications are only secure if the pseudo-random number generators provide output which is indistinguishable from random. So the way we usually write it is that the PRNG gets a short seed which is supposed to be random, but it's short. And then it generates a longer output. And it's secure if this longer output is indistinguishable from a truly random string of the same source. I hope that you all know this definition. So the output of the generator should be indistinguishable from a truly random one. And here, assume that the generator gets a small seed, which is truly random. In practice, it gets more seeding information, which is not truly random, like all kinds of timing events of what I do with my computer and so on. So it doesn't get a short seed, which is random. It gets lots of somewhat random, you know, events that have some entropy, and it tries to get from them a string which is indistinguishable from random. So how can we use random numbers in programs? One option is to use pure hardware number generators, like the one, you know, designed by Intel. The problem is that it might be, you know, expensive. It doesn't. Might not be on each device we're using. And if I want to write an application, first of all, I want to run on all devices, not only those that have this hardware number generator. Also, I don't want to mess with the API of actually talking to this random number generator, especially if on different systems it's going to be a different API. So I want someone, you know, higher up to generate the random numbers for me. Another option is to write the pseudo random number generator myself. However, the application sits too high up, you know, in the system. It doesn't get access to a lot of noise that happens down, you know, somewhere down there, like, you know, all kinds of events happening in the system. It doesn't have enough entropy. And also, writing a good pseudo-random number generator is hard. So we don't want to leave it to the application writers. So we end up with the operating system providing the pseudo-random number generator. On one hand, it can access system events like maybe a hardware number, random number generator, the time, all kinds of disk timings, user keystrokes, whatever. And it can provide an API that provides access to random numbers to any application that's running on top of it. And since we only write it once for all those who are going to use the system, then the implementer can be, you know, more educated and do his work better than some application writer who has a lot of other things to do. So back then, we thought, you know, why should we investigate the pseudo-random number generators operating system? So, okay, because it's important. I mean, all the cryptographic and security code that sits on top of that depends on the security of the random numbers that are generated, okay, by the pseudo-random number generator. So we have, you know, it makes sense to investigate what's happening there. So, and by in the time we were working on that, the algorithms and the code were not published. Okay, so in case of Windows, the code We only had the executable. In case of Linux, we had the source code, but it was 2,500 lines of code, and no one knew what's happening. No one except the writer knew what's happening inside. We also, even if we have the code, we don't know how it's initialized, what's the initial C that's used by it. And you know, everyone uses it. So it seems like a good task to look at. So that's what we did. So how this pseudo-random number generator works, so it's different than what you know we think about in cryptography. In cryptography, we have a seed and we generate an output. So here we have a generator. It keeps a certain state, and there is a deterministic function which takes the state, moves to the other state, and provides some output. So basically, this might be the initial seed, and then we provide output, move to the next state, provide output, move to the next step, and so on. Something else that happens there is that the state is being refreshed periodically. So as the system runs, the operating system reads a lot of system events, and somehow generates more entropy, and from time to time, it inserts this entropy into the state to kind of make it more random, okay? So this is different than at least the theoretical model that was investigated earlier of pseudo-random number generators, where you have a seed, and this function gets an input, provides an output. Here it's a continuous operation. It provides output whenever someone calls and asks for an output. And from time to time, we kind of refresh the state of this function. When we analyze the security, we assume that everything is known. We assume that the adversary knows exactly what's the function that is being implemented here. We know, you know, he can ask for outputs. The only thing that we don't assume the adversary to know is what's the system entropy which is being input into the pseudo-random number generator. Okay, and the manufacturer of the operating system might try to hide this function that advances the random number generator, but you can do reverse engineering. We managed to do that with a couple of students, so it's possible to do this if you're determined enough. So we must assume that the function is known. Okay. So what security properties do we want, or that were stated like in the you know, practical world? So one obvious thing is pseudo-randomness. The output should be indistinguishable from random. So if this system entropy is a random state, a short random string, the output should be indistinguishable from random. Therefore, it can be used instead of truly random bits. Another property is backward security, which is break in recovery. I'm always confused between what's backward and what's forward. So let's see what's backward, because you can also think. Backward security looks like a forward thing to me, but this is how it's defined. So an attacker that learns the internal state cannot learn future outputs of the generator, assuming that sufficient entropy is used to refresh the state. So we have this state, and now someone breaks into the system and learns the state. So of course, he can use the deterministic function that advances the state to learn future outputs. But at some point, we have new system entropy being added to the generator. And from that point on, the attacker should not be able to learn the outputs of the generator. Okay, so this is, I look at it like future, but it's called backward security. Okay, so security from things that happens back in the past. The inverse property is forward security, and it means that given the state at time I plus one, it's hard to compute any previous state. Okay, so given the current state, it's hard to compute previous states of the generator. And going forward in time, what we showed in our attacks that at the time the generators both of Linux and Windows didn't have forward security. So if you could break into the system right now, you could learn all previous states and previous outputs of the generator. So all keys that were used by whoever was using this machine to connect to all kinds of services on the internet in the past, and of course also in the future and until the next refresh. So why is forward security important? So security systems are secure as long as no one breaks into them. If you don't have forward security, then someone broke into the system, you can go back in time and learn also what happened in the past. I'll skip about this. Okay. So cryptanalysis of the Windows random number generator. This was in CCS 2007. Okay. So in Windows, yeah. We were able to go back. Yeah, you can even reveal the seed, yeah. So you can go all the way back until the beginning of, you know, whenever the system was restarted. Yeah. So, okay, CryptGen Random is the only API that Windows provide. Okay, I'm not familiar with the current state of the art. I know what was the state of the art 10 years ago, okay? But it doesn't matter because we're not here to talk about, you know, what's the current state of the art of random number generators. We're here to talk about how you should design good random number generators. Okay, so it's, you know, things might be different today, but it's also interesting to learn what, you know, what was the case, what was the, you know, what was happening 10 years ago. And actually, the time we looked at it, we were first to actually look as cryptographers. Or at least in the academic world, to see how these things work. So it's and it paid because after we looked at you know how the generators worked, the those who build them changed the constructions to be more secure. So okay, going back to the talk. So CryptGen Random is the only API that Windows provides to get secure random number generators. So it's probably, at the time at least, the most common pseudo-random number generator used in the world. And it's used by Internet Explorer to generate SSL keys. At the time, Mozilla was using something else. Chrome was not very strong at the time, so I don't know what Chrome is using. And the code and the design were not known. It was a black box, and Microsoft said, OK, just trust us. So we examined the binary code of Windows 2000 because that was, you know, what was you know, used back then. And you know, Leo Dorendorf, very talented, did the reverse engineering of the source of the executable to learn the code of the random number generators. Okay, and we identified the algorithm. Using static and dynamic reverse engineering. And then we verified the algorithm by writing a simulator. We thought we understood how the algorithm works. So then you write a code that implements your understanding of how the algorithm works. And you run it side by side with the actual Windows, and you verify that both of them provide the same output. So therefore, you know, this kind of verifies that you actually identified the actual code that is used by the actual system. And then we show the tags. OK, so this is the code. OK, this is, OK, I mean, it's a long code, but this is like the heart of the code. And actually, when I presented it at, actually, it was here in Barcelona in the RAMP session of Eurocrypt. And that was the first time you know, someone presented this source code of the Windows API. And then a lot of people in the crowd took out their cameras and took photos of the. And then I felt like a, you know, a rock star, a celebrity, because you know, I give a talk and all you see is flashes from the no cameras. I mean, no one's taking photos of the code today. But that was actually because I mean, no one knew how you know, what the code looked like at the time. Okay, so what's happening here? Okay, so we have okay, we want to read from the this generator. We want to read len bytes into a buffer. So as long as we need to read more bytes. Let me see here. Okay, there's a state. The state of the generator has two registers, each is 20 bytes long, R and state. So R is being XORed with 20 bytes you get from some RC4 instances. RC4 is a stream, a stream cipher. Then you XOR R into state. Then T is almost SHA-1 of the state, and then this SHA-1 of this state is what you output to the buffer. Then you take part of your output, and you change part of R using part of this output. And then you add 1 to state and to R. And you go back here. And since you read 5 bytes here, why do you reduce 20, I'm not sure. Maybe there's a bug in what I wrote. But that's the code. So basically, the code here is R and state. And this is how they change based on SHA-1 and RC4. So you look at it, I know I'm not a cryptanalyst, but try to understand what's happening here. OK, so this is the output. Output gets a SHA-1 of the state. SHA-1 is a hash function. And this is how we work. We take RC4, which is a stream cipher, actually several instances that, OK, they somehow take all kinds of system events and add this. I know they initialize with, they are initialized with system events, and then they just work to generate a longer stream. You add it here, so it's unclear what's happening. Something that we noticed was very odd is that, OK, you XOR into state, and then you don't change R, and then you add R into state, and you add 1. Okay. So XOR and addition are almost the same. I mean, XOR and addition are only different if you have a carry bit. So it's almost like, think of this like XOR instead of addition. It's not the same. But so it's like you XOR to state, and then you XOR again, so you kind of remove R. So it's not like that, but it's kind of almost like that. This looked very odd. So we actually reused it afterwards. Yeah. Okay, so that's a good question. So I think I have something about it, but they take, when the system starts running, they take a lot of, I think about 2,500 different bytes. They initialize an RC4 state with these bytes, or several RC4 states, and from that point on, they continue generating more and more bytes. And the question is, you know, we were not able to identify exactly how the system affects initialization. Now, you really have to understand how Windows is being initialized. It's like it's a complete mess. If you know what, I mean, if you could tamper with that, then everything is broken. But we don't know what's happening there. Yeah? So there is some fresh entropy coming in, but not very frequently. I'll describe. So at least, yeah, there's no fresh entropy here. This RC4 is something you initialize supposedly with a random key at the beginning, and then it kind of it adds entropy. Without it, then everything is kind of predictable, I guess. This R is almost, you can always remove it. OK, so what's the big picture? OK, so a different state of this random number generator is kept for every thread in the system. And RC4 is in static DLL space. R and state are in the stack, meaning that common attacks like buffer overflows or like very simple attacks can be used to get this information. They're not hidden in kernel space, which is harder for attackers to get into. It's like they're kind of in the application area where it's kind of easy to get them. Okay, so they're not well kept. Also, it's important that there's a different copy for each thread. The initialization, you take 500 something bytes of system data, most of it predictable, but not all of it. Like internal states, CPU queries, whatever, registry keys, you hash everything together and you generate the initial RC4 states. We don't know what's happening here. If someone can tamper with it, then that's the end. Now, the system is reseeded with fresh entropy after we generated 128 kilobytes of output. The problem is that we have a different instance per thread. So threads usually don't use this much output. So think about a browser that uses some randomness to generate TLS handshakes. It's not going to use 128 kilobytes. Even it's going to run for a month or so. So essentially, refresh never happens, okay? Unless in very rare cases, you should start from the initial state and just go forward. Okay, so something which is not surprising is that if someone breaks and gets the current state, they can compute all future steps once we provided the algorithm, okay? And it's not hard to get the state because it's kind of in application area. It's not hidden inside the kernel. Okay? And this is problematic because the refresh only happens after you generate 120 kilobytes for this specific thread. This means that it never happens for many, you know, for many important applications. So this is severe. I mean, you go for the coffee break, I break into your machine. Okay, I get the state. That's the end until you do a restart. I mean, until you restart your computer. Okay. Now, we don't know how to break the pseudo-randomness of the generator. I don't know. We tried. We're not great cryptanalysts. I think that other cryptanalysts looked at it. Nothing was published. So it's probably secure. So we don't know how to distinguish the output from random, assuming that the initial initialization was random. We do have an attack on forward security, meaning that we can learn previous states. So, and the main issue, the main thing that enabled the attack is that RC4 is a good, well, it's not a good stream cipher. It's being phased out, but it was good enough for these purposes. However, it was not designed to provide forward security. So I won't show you the code of RC4, but something that the designers, meaning Ron Rivest, who designed RC4, didn't care enough about was forward security. He didn't make it, so what's possible to do with RC4 is that if I get the current state of RC4, it's very easy to go back in time and compute the previous states of RC4. So for the application where you use it for encryption, it doesn't matter because, you know, I encrypt data and it should be secure against someone who eavesdropped to it, and no one assumes that someone gets into my machine and gets my key. If they get my key or get my current state, then that's the end of the game. Here, however, if someone gets the, you know, breaks into your machine right now, and they get the state of the RC4, you know, instances running on your machine, they'd be able to reverse the algorithm of RC4 and generate all future states of RC4, excuse me, reverse and compute all previous states of RC4 and all previous outputs. I won't show you how to do it, but this is trivial if you see the code. So given that, we show that given the current state of crypt gen random, it's possible to compute the previous state with 2 to the 23 work, which is like a sub-second computation, like eight million. It's basically 8 million invocations of SHA-1. Okay? And part of the attack is based on the exploiting the relation between XOR and addition. I'll show you a bit about the attack in a minute. Okay. Actually, there's an even simpler attack. So think about the system. We have the state and the R, these two registers, okay? And we have RC4. RC4 is initialized with all this system information that we cannot model. So let's assume it's totally random. State and R are not initialized. They kind of, when the system runs, then this loop I showed you changes them with data, with bits coming from RC4. But they're initialized with whatever happens to be in these variables when you start running the system, and this is predictable, okay? So if I look at the system, I know the initial states of state and R, okay? And I don't know what's the initial state of RC4. That's always true. Now you go for your coffee break, I break into your machine, and I get the current state of S and R, and I also get the current state of your RC4, okay? Since RC4 doesn't provide forward security, I can take this current state of RC4 in your system and rewind it in time all the way to the initial state. So now I have the initial state of RC4 in your system. I have the initial states of S and R because they're the same in all machines. They're kind of predictable. And from there, I can go, you know, run the algorithm and go to the future and compute, you know, everything that your machine did until this time. Okay? So since RC4 doesn't have forward security, nothing has forward security if you know the initial states of state and R. And if you, even if you don't know them, I'll show you a little bit about the attack, which takes 2 to the 23 time to work to go back. So before showing the details of the attack, let's talk about the implications. So we notified Microsoft, and they said, this is a local information disclosure, a vulnerability, and has no possibility of code execution. Meaning, it doesn't let someone break into your machine, it just lets someone who already has access to your machine learn more about it. So what they said at the time was, if someone can get the state of your pseudo-random number generator, then it means that they already have access to your machine, then if someone has access to your machine, then we don't care. I mean, we cannot protect you anymore. What we said is that if someone breaks into a machine, like doing the coming coffee break, then okay, it's kind of legitimate for them to learn everything that is on the machine at that time. But what the attack enables is for them to go back on time and learn things I've been doing with the machine in the past. So this is, that's not cool. That's not legitimate, okay? It's something you should protect against. And this is why I think the attack is interesting. So basically, the implication is if someone breaks into my machine now, then obviously they can go forward in time until the next refresh. And using the attack, they can go backwards in time until the last refresh. And this is usually the time the machine was restarted, and the next refresh is not going to happen any time. So we can learn all the outputs of the random number generator. Okay, 120 k bytes. Okay, so let's look a little bit about the attack. I'll just look at basic things. So I'm not a cryptanalyst. It's like very basic. Okay, I'm not Elie Biham, who just did very basic things. Okay, so what have here? We have here state and R. RC states are being XORed to R. This is being XORed to state. We take SHA-1 of that. We put it into R. Okay, this is the output. We take SHA-1 of the output, put it into R, and we add it with state and 1. This is the new value of state. So this is the output. We replace some part of R with it, add 1, add state. This is the new value of state. Okay, so what does the attacker know? He breaks into the system. He knows the current RC4 state, the current R state, and the current state. Okay, he knew this, he knows this, and he knows this. So therefore, he knows SHA-1, because this is, he knows state. State XOR equals new state. If you know new state and R, you can go back in time and compute the previous state. So you can do that. And he also knows the output, at least part of it. And then, okay, here we had the RC state that goes XORed with here and go, okay. This is the same as this, except that we replaced the last 5 bytes with something we got from the output. So we know this value, so therefore we know this value except for the last 5 bytes. We know this value entirely because that's the RC4 state. Therefore, this is the equal to XOR of this and that. So we know this entirely except for these last 5 bytes. And we know this, okay, we know this entirely. We know this except for 5 bytes, so we know this except for 5 bytes. Okay? So basically, just by arithmetic, I can compute the previous state except for 40 bytes. Okay? So, I can go back. So I can, going forward or backward in time? This is more about, okay, so basically, okay, I have everything, I have the previous, I have like 40 bits of entropy about the previous states. I can check all 2 to the 40 instances, compare the output that I have to the current output that I, the output that I picked from the system to the output that is derived from that state and see if they match or not. And then you have 2 to the 40 options for the missing 5 bytes. You have, I think 2 to the 40, we have a single 40-bit output. You check, you're going to get the right one is going to pass the check. You also expect to get some other false positive. But then you can compute, you compute a martingale, whatever. You compute the number of false positives that you expect to find, and it's very small. So basically, this is enough to break the system. It requires some analysis, but this is, yeah? whatever. So you start, you have one false positive from that. No, you have one value. From that, you expect to get the true value of the previous state you're going to identify. Also going to identify one false positive. So you have like two. You go back in time. So this false positive, sometime in the past, you're going to see that it's actually not, doesn't make sense because it's not going to have any ancestor. And some are going to have ancestors. But if you do the analysis with martingales, you're going to see that you're going to end up with a very small set of possible seeds. And they're gonna, and the true one is going to stay inside, and the other ones are going to fall after a while. Okay. And then we had this. Okay, this is the attack. It's kind of simple. We have a more complicated attack that took only 2 to the 23 SHA-1 calculations. And it used the relation between addition and exclusive OR. So this enabled us to do a better attack. And like even at the time, you can do to the 23 SHA-1 invocations in less than a second. Now it's a fraction of a second. So it's like a very practical attack. And just to tell you, at some point during the analysis, we thought that we had like a complete break. Like we could break everything about the system, learn, distinguish it from being pseudo-random. At that time, we freaked out. Like I remember we were sitting at a cafe. We said, OK, we found a bug that kind of enables the NSA to eavesdrop to all Windows machine. What do we do? What do we do now? It was pre-Snowden. And luckily, after a few hours, we found that we were wrong, and the things are. So the randomness is OK. There's only this attack, which is kind of, it's not as severe as having the truth, the pseudo-randomness being completely junk. Okay, so this was, remember, it was Windows 2000. At the time, XP was the more important system. So XP had the same pseudo-random number generator that RC4 was replaced with something else. This is just telling you, the experiences that we had at the time, in case you're going to do something similar with other systems. And we didn't want to spend months trying to reverse engineer the code of this thing, okay? Because we didn't know what's happening there. It was more complex. But if there was no forward security there, it would mean that XP was also susceptible to all the attacks that we had. So we asked Microsoft, and the initial answer was that later versions of Windows, meaning XP, contain various changes and enhancements to the random number generator, okay? This was, okay, so it's better. But the question, okay, was, we continued answering, and we had a journalist who asked this for us, like, okay, it's better, but is it secure against this attack? And the answer was XP, it's better, but it's also vulnerable to this attack. But then they changed the code to make it secure against the attack, okay? And like the lesson here is they give you an answer and it's not clear, then you should ask again. No, the code, as far as I know, the code is closed. You don't know what's happening there. That's a problem with doing this research. Like you invest months doing reverse engineering, and then you might end up seeing that everything is working fine. Okay. So if you're the first one to do it, then most likely it's not going to be fine. If now you're going to do it, then I don't know. As far as I know, did they analyze Windows? Or did they just?
I'm looking at their abstract.
Okay, so as far as I thought, they only wrote how you should be doing it. They also analyzed. How the paper is called? It's.
This is how to eat your entropy and have it too?
Yeah, yeah, that's the paper. How to eat your entropy. Okay, so I'm not surprised that Windows is actually good at this point.
So a good place to look to see at least what part of their implementation is that this certification list tells you what you're using.
So it has what Windows are using there. Okay, so I'm afraid I'm not following the what's state what's happening, but it's I assume so. It's probably true that it's secure at this point.
Okay.
However, okay, it's probably secure, but this is like the future work that we suggested at the time. So look at future windows like Vista, whatever. Win 7, Win 10, which is probably secure. However, something that people did not investigate is how you initialize the state. I mean, this 3,500 bits that you pick from different operating system events and you initialize the state with them, what's happening there? So to do that, you'll have to run a lot of, I guess, system copies and try to estimate what's the entropy that you have there. And perhaps there's some no entropy in some area which later affects the entire state. You know, I don't know. It's a huge project to do that. Okay, but if this is insecure, then everything is insecure. Okay. And one recommendation is to switch to design which supports forward security. Barak Halevi at the time had a paper on how to design random number generators. And I skimmed the recent paper of Yevgeny, I have a reference to it later. Yevgeny, Adi Shamir, Daniel Weeks, and some other person, I'll say them in a few slides, also provides a design. And also you have to wiki more often, okay? You have to add entropy more often because if someone breaks into your system, you want to limit the effect of that attack. Okay. Now I'll describe the attack on Linux, which was actually earlier work before the attack on Windows. Okay, so the Linux random number generator was generated essentially by a single person from 94 till this day, Theodore Tso. It's implemented in the kernel, which is better than in the user space because it's harder to break into there and get to the state. It's very complex and it changed like on a weekly basis. So he keeps changing it. He's the master of the random number generator. The design I'm going to describe have been changed afterwards, but I'll describe what was happening then. So there are two interfaces. One is for kernel functions, another is for users. The user have two interfaces, dev random and dev view random. The dev random is a blocking interface which is supposed to be more secure, meaning that it doesn't provide output unless it thinks that it has enough physical entropy. Okay? Dev view random always provides you output. People don't like using dev random because it might just block and won't give you output because it has enough of physical entropy. Okay? So they mostly use dev view random. Actually, if you have good seeding, you don't need dev random. You can just use the pseudo random number generator. But okay, you have these two interfaces. Okay, so it was open source. However, it was 2,500 lines of code, unclear, and it was constantly being patched. So we had to just get one version, analyze it using static analysis, then do changes to the kernel to see what's happening if you do this change, and then you write a simulator and verify that it provides the same output as the actual implementation. And I know I didn't do any of this work, but it's a very tedious and annoying work, even though it was open source. And this actually tells us something about open source. Linus Torvalds said something like, no bag is too deep if there are many eyes looking at the code, something like that. However, here we have code, and I'm sure no one except for Theodore Tso and those who tried to break and actually abuse the system understood everything that's happening in that random number generator. Okay? So it's open source, but actually very few people analyze the code. So open source is not a name for security because it's hard to understand what's happening. Okay, so the structure is that you take lots of entropy sources like keyboard timings, mouse timings, interrupts, disk timings. You have a primary entropy pool, and then you have output going there for to a secondary pool and to the random random pool. This provides the dev random output. This provides the dev u random output. They have some counter which estimates how much entropy you get and how much entropy you take. And if you took too much entropy and you didn't add enough entropy from here, then this dev random blocks doesn't give you more output. And dev u random is happy to give you more output. Of course, we know as cryptographers that if there was an initial seed which was random enough, you can provide, you know, any polynomially sized output, which and it's still going to be secure. However, with dev random, they want to get like physical entropy. Okay. Entropy is always gathered, and refresh happens all the time. Unlike Windows, which only refreshes at infinity, here they keep refreshing the state. An event has two words representing it. One is the event type, which is predictable. This is a mouse click, whatever. And the other is the timing in milliseconds. In each event, there is very limited entropy. We measured hard disks, hard disk accesses, and we had like 1 bit per hard disk access at the most. But the good news, there are many events, and they can have kind of refresh the system. So we had an attack. However, it was less severe. It took us to attack forward security 2 to the 64 work compared to 2 to the 23. So the attack is less severe. Also in Linux, it seems to be more secure. It's in kernel space. It's hard to get it. It's the same generator used for all processors. So in one side, one process finds it, you know, can access the generator of another process. That's not so good. On the other hand, you have just one copy. It's more protected. We have this blocking interface that people don't like because you want to get random output and you don't think it can provide it to you, so it just blocks and your program doesn't run. So this blocking interface is susceptible to denial of service attacks. So for instance, if you run like a super secure application that needs output from dev random, and I can somehow get a lot of random outputs from your system, from say another process on your system, which uses dev u random, just I'm saying sending pings to your machine or whatever, then I can block the random generator on your machine. Because I'm going back to this. So if you have something on your system that wants to get output from here, and I can make something else on your system generate output from here. Suppose I'm sending a lot of pings to your machine, and when you send TCP answers, you should put some randomness there, you get it from here. Then I've kind of drained the entropy count. So when your super important application wants to get output from here, then the generator tells her, sorry, I don't have enough physical entropy, you should wait. So this enables denial of service attacks, and that's not good. Okay. Also, there was future work in 2012. These authors had a paper, the Linux pseudorandom number generator revisited. They examined the changes that were done between our work and that time. There were quite a few changes. They described the state of the generator, and they didn't describe any new attacks. So it's kind of okay. And there's also this newer work on Yevgeny, Adi Shamir, Stefan Davidovich, and Daniel Wicks, who designed optimal recovery strategies for compromised RNGs, how to enter new entropy to your to the generator. However, there's a big issue with using the Linux random number generator with systems without hard disk. I'll describe this in a minute. But before that, I'll say something else. So we found essentially issues, the forward security issue, both with the Linux random number generator and with Windows. And basically, we told both Microsoft and the Linux developers about these issues and asked them to change to fix the system. So the answers we got were very different. Okay, for Microsoft, they said, that's no problem. We said, it's still a problem, and they said, okay, we're going to fix the system, and they fixed the system. With the Linux people, it was more like a religious war. Like if you look at things that were written about us at, you know, at that time in Linux forums, they really trash us as academics who don't know anything. And the thing is that for Microsoft is, they said, you know, it's secure, it's theoretical attacks, we don't have to fix anything. And the thing is that with Microsoft, it's a company, right? It's a business issue, we fix it. For them, you know, for someone who invests a lot of his free time, you know, working and trying to make the system, the random number generator of Unix or Linux or other parts of Linux, this is like, you know, something, you know, he cares about, he owns, and they don't like someone else coming and telling them what to do. So it was much harder to convince the Linux people to change the system than to convince Microsoft. Okay, and that's, I don't know, something to think about also with regards to security of open source systems, because it's like, at the end, it's like a few people who decide what's happening there. Okay, so what happens with diskless systems? So at the time, people, you know, 2006, people started, those who had a lot of money, to replace hard disk with solid state drives. Okay, now it's very common. And the problem is that with hard disk read-write operations, you have variance in the timing on how much it takes you to read something from disk. And there's actually a paper from 1990 about, actually, if you have a hard disk, you have a disk that rotates. If it rotates, it generates air turbulence. The air turbulence provides entropy that is unpredictable. Okay, and this is actually the source of randomness. If you have a solid state drive, then all read operations are kind of digital, and there's no randomness, there's no entropy there. Okay, now that's a problem because with the random number generator of Linux, hard disk timings are the major source of entropy. So if you take this RNG, just, you know, and you put it on a system without a hard drive, just with a solid state drive, you lose the major source of entropy. And the other sources of entropy are very limited. User input, system interrupts, they might be guests. Or if you think about a system like a router, I mean, there's no user input, okay? There's no mouse, there's nothing there, okay? Just the hard disk and network operations if you measure them, but at the time they were not measuring network interrupts. Okay, so we speculated this might be a threat to the security of Linux RNG in future systems. We did some preliminary exams. I'll show you in a minute. So actually, the developers of the RNG had some recommendations. They said, okay, we don't trust the source of entropy so much, so the system should somehow continue when you shut it down. So whenever you shut down a Linux system, it should take the current state of the random number generator, store it, save it, and when it starts booting up again, it should take that state and use it as the base for its new operation. That's great. This is done by the Linux distribution. However, if you have it, a Linux distribution on a CD or DVD, okay, which is not writable, then you cannot save the state because there's nowhere to save the state. And a lot of systems like routers, or if you're using OpenWRT routers, which are used to be very popular, they don't save the state. They just didn't bother doing that. So then we took a specific device. This was a PDA made by Nokia. I mean, no one uses it today. And we examined it, and then we saw that this device always boots with one of only six possible values for the random number generator. So when you boot the device, the random number generator has only one of six states. And this happened because the device used SSD, so it didn't have any source of entropy. Also, the developers didn't save the state when the device was shut down. So it always started from the same state. Also, during the reboot, the RNG should take the current time of day and enter it into the RNG should be initialized with the current time of day when you reboot the system. So this should prevent this observation we had, because at least it should start with initialization, which is based on the time of day. However, and another thing, so it takes the current time of day, and also it should read some values from a hardware-based noise generator. And then we didn't see this happening, and we looked what's happening there. So what's happening is that the RNG was initialized so early in the boot process, so the hardware random number generator at that time was still kind of cold and didn't provide any output. So it was always fixed. And the hardware clock indeed had the real time. However, during boot, the hardware clock is being copied to the software clock. And the RNG took the software clock and copied it to the state. What happened that the RNG was running before the software clock was updated, so it always was updating. So, okay, these guys, the guys who designed this machine, I mean, they were not stupid, but they were busy, okay? And they said, okay, we have an RNG for Linux, let's use it. We didn't think about how it's initialized and how to make it better. And we didn't observe these issues. So one of the good things that should have come out of our work is that people should look how the system they're using actually, what they do and whether it makes sense to just take some random, some piece of code and use it on a new device. So then we thought about doing something more interesting. So we could, since this machine always started in a specific, with a specific value, one of six values for the generator, then we put like code which, whenever the machine started, it ran an SSH connection to a remote host. And since the SSH connection took a key from this random number generator, it always used one of six keys in this connection, so we could eavesdrop for that. Then we thought about doing something more complicated, but this didn't work because it was too complicated. And the idea was the following. Okay, so we have this RNG. It starts from like a fixed state. The only thing that is going to change the state is the events that the RNG copies. And the only meaningful events that were relevant at the time was user input. So basically, the RNG is going to change its state based on user input. Okay, so other applications might connect to this machine from outside, say ping the machine, and get output from the RNG, which is based on the user input. So perhaps if we, take this device, ask the user not to do anything, and ping the machine from outside, we'll get output which depends on the observable state. State that we know is going to be the first one. Then we ask the user to just click on one point on the machine. This is going to change the value of the state of the RNG. We're going to ping the machine again from outside, and we get an output which depends on the input that the user entered to the machine. So this should enable us to do a brute force on all possible inputs of the user and learn what input the user gave to the machine. And if the user is doing his input slowly enough and we ping the machine fast enough, perhaps we can eavesdrop to what the user is typing just because this affects how the RNG works. And so we did some measurements. It didn't work. It worked if we had to do some change to the RNG and we typed very slowly, whatever. But potentially it might work because, there is a source here, like this random number generator. It's being affected by user input and it provides output to the whoever pings it from outside. Okay? So potentially there might be a system where this might be possible. Okay, so then we forgot about it. And then it was very impressive work about mining your P's and Q's by Henninger, Dumerik, Wustrow, and Alex Haldeman, which I'm sure some of you have heard of it. What they did a large scan of many machines on the internet and checked the keys that they were using. So what happens, they checked the public keys machines were using. So think about RSA. If two hosts have different moduli and they have the same E, that's okay. Everyone uses the same E, which is 3. That's fine. If two hosts have the same N, I would say public keys, that's not so good because the private key of one host can decrypt messages sent to the other host. Now, what happens if they have different Ns, but N equals P times Q, so we have N1 and N2, which are different, but P1 is equal to P2, and Q1 is different than Q2. So these two public keys share one prime and have the different prime being different. So what happens there? Why this is totally insecure, because if now we do computer GCD of N1 and N2, we're going to get P, okay? And with P, we can factor both N1 and N2. So this is really bad, okay? And the time to compute the GCD is 15 microseconds, which is very fast for breaking, I would say, okay? The same thing if we're using DSA signatures or ECDSA. What happens if we repeat the same nonce? So okay, why should different devices have the same P's and different Q's? If somehow the hardware number, the pseudo-random number generators are not working properly, okay? Otherwise, just by pure collision, it's not going to happen. Now, suppose someone else who's doing RSA signatures, and in these signatures, you need some nonce in these signatures. What happens if you have a weak source of randomness and you repeat the same nonce twice? And that's, I think, pretty popular homework, question in intro to crypto courses. It's easy to show that the DSA signature in that case is completely broken. Okay, so it's important to use random numbers. In this case, you can break signatures. In this case, you can factor RSA keys. So we don't expect to see two RSA keys colliding in the wild. However, they checked 400 million RSA keys, and they used a variant of an algorithm of Dan Bernstein for computing the pairwise GCD of many numbers. And this enabled them to compute the private keys of 0.5% of all HTTPS servers and 0.3% of all SSH servers. So these are cases where two different servers had different ends, which are the same P and different Qs. So this is like a complete catastrophe for both servers, okay? And this is one out of 200 HTTPS servers had this problem. That's very bad, okay? And also, a lot of devices had repeated keys, the same N happening over and over again. And most keys that had this property were generated by network devices like this router that we also looked at. And they all have used SSDs and not hard drives. And otherwise have very weak sources of randomness. The thing what happens there is that they gather some randomness from operating system events. So even this device that we checked had it started from 1 out of 6 possible states. So if indeed it didn't have any entropy, it would always start from one state. But it had very limited entropy, so during the boot up process, it ended up with 1 out of 6 states. With these devices or similar ones, when they start, they starting to get entropy. So for the first P, they generate an RSA key. For the first P, they have some entropy. For the second, for the Q, they have more entropy. So the P's are kind of very likely to be the same. The Q's are going to be different. This enables this attack, which is very bad. And again, this happened because people, took existing, software and threw them on a new device without thinking what's working in this device and what's not. So this is it's funny from the authors of that paper. They had to do a disclosure to, all these companies. So they had to disclose this to 61 companies. Only 13 had contact info telling them who to contact, okay? Only 28 answered. 13 said that they're gonna fix the problem. 5 said we only thought about it. We already solved this in the past. This resulted in changes to the Linux kernel to use other sources of randomness. And they said that afterwards, I think this is from a year afterwards, they had a 20% decrease in the number of hosts that have RSA, factorable RSA keys, because people deploy these changes. So this is an example how a weak generator can affect security in a very bad way. Okay, so the take-home messages from this part is, be careful with using a generator that you don't understand, okay? Or where, in this case, it's specifically when designing a system without a hard disk. So you take software for a generator, you should understand what's happening there, not just throw it into a new system, because then it might not work properly. Also, collect entropy more aggressively and add hardware sources. Seed devices with entropy at factory, if possible, so we don't rely on users. And run for a while before generating cryptographic keys, because as the system is running, it gathers more and more entropy, and a lot of weak entropy ends up being good. It's not the end of my talk. I have another, even more fun part. So the take home for Windows is to examine other Windows systems, which are probably secure, if Microsoft is doing their work properly, which they probably are doing, and also understand the relation with the operating system, the initialization. I think this is like very important, and I don't think that anyone understands it, unless someone is trying to abuse this relation. With Linux, the main problem was diskless systems. Something else I wanted to do but we didn't do is about what happens with random number generators running inside virtual machines. So a virtual machine, okay, it's a state of the machine, and then you can copy many copies of the virtual machine, and they have the same value for the random number generator. Then you start running them here and there in different locations, and if they don't gather enough entropy from the time they start running until they do sensitive things with their data, with random numbers, then some things might behave bad. Okay, so suppose you have one virtual machine, it has a state, then you make 100 or 1,000 copies of them, they all start running from the same value of the random number generator, and if they use it at the same time, it's probably not good. If they use it after getting a little bit entropy, it might be good, might not be good. What's the attack scenario? I don't know, but it's interesting. And also, people who use virtual machines, they don't think about it. And unless someone designs, the operating system to support good security for that, then, okay, there might be a problem. Okay, for another discussion of implementations of random number generators, and here it's not that the developers were not educated enough. Here it seems that the developers actually wanted to enable backdoors into the system using the random number generator. So this is what we say called the dual EC DRBG saga. Okay, cryptography backdoors. Okay, so it's best covered in a paper from this year's CCS, a systematic analysis of the Juniper dual EC incident by a lot of authors. I'm not going to read all the names, okay? But it's a very impressive work that they did. So EC is based on elliptic curves. So just sort of thing is like, it's like working modulo P, okay? But you work in a different group, and points on a group satisfy this equation. Each point has an X and a Y. And for an X, you have two values for Y. And for a random point, the entropy is in X, okay? I usually think modulo P, not in elliptic curve, it's the same. So the discrete log and the Diffie-Hellman problems are defined also in elliptic curves. So G is a group of order Q, and P is a generator. The discrete log problem here is that given Q, which is R times P for R, which we don't know, and is random, find the value R. So it's like the discrete log modulo P, but here we should find, it's like doing for it for multiplications, not for exponentiations. And the DDH problem here is giving P, Q, R, and S, where Q is random, determine if R is R times, whether there's a, you know, lowercase r, so that uppercase R is R times P and S is R times Q, or whether these two values are random. Okay, whether they have the same discrete log, whether R and S have the same discrete log to the bases P and Q or not. This is just Diffie-Hellman in multiplication. Okay, so back in 2006, NIST suggested this generator. Okay, what's that? So the state is P. And you get this value T. Okay, it's kind of a refresh value. And you multiply P by, okay, P is an elliptic curve point. You multiply P by T, then you take the x coordinate. And then you take some bits out of the x coordinate. You take an integer out of the x coordinate. So basically, it's the x coordinate, okay? And we do it two things. One is to take it back and read it back here. It's always read back here. And then you multiply the x coordinate back into the into P. So you multiply, you take P raised to the power of T, take the x coordinate, some bits from there, that's the new T, and raise P to that power again, 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 again. Multiply it again, 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 again. You also take that S, that x coordinate, multiply Q, that's the other part of the stake, by S, takes the x coordinate, take this output, extract some bit, and this is the output of the generator. So basically, the state here has P and Q. You raise them by this, you multiply them by this S here that goes back, and then you take some bits out of Q and you output them. Okay, so the internal state at Si, the state is updated by computing Si plus 1 is Si times P, and you take the x coordinate and again. And the value that you output is Si times Q. Takes the x coordinate, you remove 16 bits, and that's the output. So this seems like, okay, first, it seems like a very silly idea. Why use public key operations to design a random number generator? We want the random number generator to be very efficient. Why use public key operations for that? This seems silly, okay? But they said, okay, this is, looks secure because it seems to be secure based on the decision of Diffie-Hellman assumption because, okay, basically what you do here, you have P and Q, and then you multiply both of them times S, S1, say. And then you take some bits of this thing and you output them. So if the decision of Diffie-Hellman assumption works, then this is random. So this is like the last component from which you output things looks random. So like, according to Diffie-Hellman, this is secure. So it's like kind of the hand-waving argument. This is secure based on the Diffie-Hellman assumption. This is why you want to use this. Okay. So then people started talking about it. What we output is the x portion of a point on the elliptic curve. So basically, it's a random field element. However, a random element in a field or in a group is not random. It's not that all of its bits are random. So take, for instance, if we walk like in modulo P, which is N23, if you look at the numbers in Z23 stars, the multiplicative group modulo 23, and you look at the group numbers there, those whose GCD with 23 is 1, then the most significant bit here is not uniform. Actually, it's 0 with probability 0.7, okay? So values, like in these groups, are not necessarily random. And actually, if you look there, then they truncate 16, the most 16 most significant bits. But people showed, when it was published, that the first bit that they publish is predictable with is predictable with this probability, and if you look at 240 bit outputs, then you can predict them with probability, with, you can distinguish them from random with this probability, which is not good. So the output is not really random. So this could have been solved. This is because you truncate 16 bits. So the most significant bit is very non-random, and you should truncate. And they only truncated 16 bits. Okay? So what you got at the end was still not very random. This could have been easily solved by, you know, truncating more bits. But they didn't want to truncate more bits. They just said, that's the standard. We're going to use that. Okay? Okay. Then there was a talk in the crypto RAM session in 2007 by Dan Schumo and Neil Ferguson for Microsoft, and titled on, these are slides from the original talk, on the possibility of a backdoor in the NIST, you know, RNG. Okay, so here's the attack. Suppose, okay, this the system used P and Q. And the output, we have the same S, and you multiply it by P and by Q, and the output is given by, you know, taken from S times Q. Now, suppose someone knew the discrete log of Q to the base P. So it didn't, they didn't generate random P and Q. They chose Q so that they knew that Q is equal to E times P. They knew the discrete log of Q to the base P. Okay, and this is easy to generate the numbers this way if you can generate them any way you want. Okay? So the assume that there was no truncation, so the output of the generator is the x coordinate of R, that is of SI times Q. Giving the S coordinate, you can find the Y coordinate because there are only two possibilities for it. And now if we know the discrete log of Q to the base P, we also know the discrete log of P to the base Q, just the inverse. So therefore, if we know, going back, if we know what's the SI times Q, we can also learn what SI times P is. And then I can compute all future states, because this is essentially the state. So if I'm going back to the initial, so the output here, it's some bit of S times Q. And the state is S times P. If I know the discrete log between Q and P, and I know this value, in actuality, I only know a few bits. But if I know this entire value, and I know the discrete log, I can easily compute this state from this value. And then I know the state. And from that on, point one, I can compute everything. OK? So. This is what it says, and it's based on the attacker choosing P and Q, which are like constants in the standard, so that the attacker will know the discrete log of Q to the base P. Okay, but you say the output is truncated, so you don't know the entire Q. However, they only truncate 16 bits. So there are basically 2 to the 16 options for the passable value of Q once you get the output. So you can go over all to the 16 options and check which one of them corresponds to the future output. So you can completely break the system. This is not enough truncation. So if you were truncating 64 bits, then attacker would have to do 2 to the 64 work to break the system. That would have been secure. But they only truncate 16 bit and not 64, 80 bits. So this is kind of suspicious. And these guys verified the attack experimentally. And then they said, oh, this is the pre-Snowden, okay? We're not saying that NIST intentionally put a backdoor there, okay? But we are saying that all the security depends on solving one instance of this elliptic curve discrete log, okay? And we don't know if the algorithm designer actually picked P and Q so that he knows the discrete log or not, so we cannot use this. Okay, and this was pre-Snowden, so you can, that time you didn't accuse the NSA of anything. Because it was like, you know, people didn't think that's going to happen. And then they said suggestions. One suggestion is to truncate more than 16 bits. And the other, okay, to generate a random point Q for each instance of the PRNG. And something else they could have done, which is very easy, is how can I convince you that I don't know that the discrete log of P to the base of q to the base p, I just choose q in a way which is, seems to be unpredictable. For instance, apply SHA-1 to the entire contents of the New York Times on a specific date or something like this. So this kind of convinces us that this value is random, and therefore I don't know the discrete log of that value, okay? But they didn't do that. Actually, there are some cryptographic standards or constructions where actually this is how they define random constants, to convince you that they chose them sort of at random. Okay, so this, you know, they had the RAM session presentation. No one talked about it afterwards, and it didn't seem to matter because who's going to use this RNG that's based on public key crypto? And then Snowden came. And these are things that appeared in documents he revealed. So this is an NSA program that says to insert vulnerabilities into commercial encryption systems, networks, and endpoint communication devices. And down here is to influence policies, standards, and specifications for commercial public key technologies, which is exactly, you know, what could have been done here. Influence standard. This was a standard. And then this is, you cannot read it, but basically RSA Security, the company, implemented this ECDSA, okay? And they got $10 million from the NSA for doing that. So they implemented this RNG. And moreover, it was the default RNG used in their systems, okay? Because, okay, you as a company, we work according to the standards, which use any, you know, option that the standard enables us. And in our marketing material, we just say that we work according to these NIST standards, which look okay. This looks fine. And then this, from all options in the standard, they chose to use this one. And it also was revealed that they got substantial amount of money from the NSA for doing that. And this is, I'm sure it's hard to read. So John Kelsey, who's from NIST, asked Don Johnson, who was a designer of Dual EC, like, this is an email. Where does this Q come from? And what he says, Q is essentially the public key for some random private key. It could also be generated like another canonical G, but NSA stopped this idea, and I was not allowed to publicly discuss it. And John Kelsey afterwards said, you know, he thought it was strange, but he was too busy and didn't make too much out of it. And that's probably the case. Okay, but then you look at more Snowden documents, and what you see here, it says Juniper. Like this says, Juniper is a major target because they control a lot of the firewall and router market, okay? So this seems like an evidence that the NSA put a backdoor into the random number generator used by Juniper products, which is a lot of the firewall market, means that they could eavesdrop to communication done through these firewalls. But this is actually where things become even more interesting, okay? So last December, Juniper had this security advisory saying there's a security advisory enables attackers who can monitor VPN traffic to decrypt the traffic, and it affects ScreenOS, that's the name of the operating system, in, you know, these versions, okay? No other versions are affected, only these versions are affected. So then people started looking what happened there, including the authors of the paper I cited at the beginning. So apparently Juniper was using this dual EC random number generator, and they used a different queue, not the one specified in the standard. And they don't say how queue was generated. So they used their own queue, okay? And this, they said something about after Snowden, we used our queue, and they don't say why they chose that queue. This is the queue that we're using, okay? So we don't know, is the queue that someone gave them? Is this the queue that they put because they want to eavesdrop to traffic? They just chose to use a specific value of Q. And something else they say is the output of this generator is never being output. It's input to another PRNG, this FIPS PRNG, and it's only being used as a seed to this PRNG. So even if there is this vulnerability and you know the queue, you don't see the output because it's the seed to another PRNG, everything should be fine. What happened when people started examining the code, so basically Juniper said, from this version, our systems are insecure, okay? Until that, it was okay. What happened is that at some point, like from the version where the system started to become insecure, according to Juniper, the Q changed. So they shipped the system with an original value of Q. At some point, this value of Q was changed. And what Juniper is saying is that they don't know who changed the value of Q. So someone broke into Juniper systems and into, I guess, into the not into the development systems of Juniper, broke into the source code of the RNG and changed the value of Q. And from that point on, the system manufactured by Juniper had someone else's backdoor working in them. Okay? Still, they say it shouldn't be a problem because we don't output the value of the random number, of the output of the random number generator. It's only being input to another random number generator. However, if you look at the implementation, and the authors of the paper did, then there's a bug in the implementation. And somehow, row output from the dual EC random number generator is being output to the network. It's like a subtle, not so subtle bug. So the backdoor can be utilized. we don't know what happened. Why did they use dual EC? Why initially they used a different queue than the one suggested in the standard? And then even more interestingly, who changed the queue? Okay? Like, who knew about the possibility of this backdoor? Someone who listened to the RAMP talk in 2007 or someone who invested a lot of investigation and knew that the system had this bug which reveals output from the random number generator. And then this person broke into Juniper and changed the value of one constant so that that person could eavesdrop to the communication. It seems like something that only states could do. That's very interesting. So, this affected Juniper's reputation. Moreover, the reputation of NIST, which for many years tried to distinct itself from the NSA, like they generate systems for standards for the good of the entire community, not just for the NSA. And we believe that NIST was actually, they did try to build good standards, but perhaps they were abused by the NSA for putting backdoors into standards. This is a document also from Snowden. The amount of money the NSA puts into putting backdoors into commercial products, it's like $275 million in 2012. That's a lot of money. Okay, that's really a lot of money. You can do a lot with that. Theodore So said after that, I'm so happy that resisted pressure from Intel to rely only on hardware random number generators, also add other random also generate randomness from all kinds of system events, because then we won't depend on one company. This whole backdoor issue also erodes the trust in SGX, the new secure execution environment from Intel, because we don't know what's happening inside. So the conclusion is that the NSA and probably many others willfully weakened the security infrastructure so that they can eavesdrop. However, this backfired in the case of the dual EC because probably someone else used the the backdoor that they put in there. So it's okay. So this is, you know, quite amazing to observe, but this is something that's, you know, affects the way we communicate. With regards to random number generators, security is very important. Okay, you saw that governments are probably willing to invest hundreds of millions of dollars in the security or insecurity of random number generators. It's very hard to examine OS-based RNGs. Even if you examine the Juniper code, unless you reveal this bug that kind of outputs part of the, you know, raw output to the network, then you think that it's not the best, but it's still secure. So it's very hard to identify backdoors. The generators of both Windows and Linux did not provide forward secure. They're probably secure this time. And they may have additional design issues. And I think that's the last slide. I'll just say again my commercial announcement from the beginning. We have this, for those who came during the talk, we are running in Bar-Ilan the 7th annual Bar-Ilan Winter School. This year is going to be on differential privacy. From theory to practice. This is a technology that's now being used by Google and Apple to protect privacy of users who report data back to the centers, let's say. And we have a very nice line of speakers. Weather is going to be probably as nice as it's here right now, but it's going to be in February. And it's going to be a fun and interesting event. Okay. Thanks. Well, the spec is open, so it depends on, okay, even if the spec is open, it's complex, okay? You have to trust Intel to implement what's in the spec. You have to trust the random number generator. It's very hard for outside observers to verify what's inside. Yeah, I think it's also hard just to verify that the spec is fine, but it's like, look at us as academics. This would take a lot of work. What incentive do you have to, you know, to work on that? Like, the most probable case is going to be that you're going to spend probably some person years on that, okay, and end up saying that everything's fine. That's not a good use of, you know, of anyone's time. I mean, it's very important for the community, but it's kind of, yeah.
I think there was a paper about who where that, you know, it's very easy to change the chip at fab time.
Oh. Yeah, it's easy to change a chip at fab time in a way that's imperceptible. So if you think you have 64 bits of entropy coming in, I can change the chip so you only have 12, let's say. And 12 is not enough for you to notice that it's constant, but enough for somebody to break it in a 2 to the 12 attack. And this you can do, you know, even if you have all the specs, open source everything, at fab time, and then you'd really have to look at a chip at a microscopic level to notice that this is happening, which is really not feasible given the size of a chip. So I think this is why you can't just trust hardware.
Okay, thanks.